his head, a plat...
decided to put
the VS of invitation. Hello. Good evening. Welcome to the April lecture of Varahamihira Science Forum. My name is Gopu. I'll give a brief introduction to the forum and the organizations involved in this process, then a brief introduction to the speaker, and then we'll get to the lecture. This host of this lecture, this venue, is Tamil Virtual Academy. It's a division of the Tamil Nadu government. They have extensive, it used to be Tamil Virtual University, so their website is still tamilvu.org. It is an extensive library of information about Tamil history, culture, heritage, literature, and so on. It has a wonderful series of web pages, a lot of videos of lectures, classes on instructions on Tamil literature, Tamil history, and so on. It's also the lecture is also organized by Tamil Heritage Trust and Varahamihira Science Forum. Tamil Heritage Trust was started about 10 years back. We hold a lot of programs, one of which is a monthly lecture series on various topics of interest in heritage, not necessarily confined to Tamil, but to India in general. One of the other programs that we do is a Pechu Kacheri, which is a combined set of lectures in a one day, is rather one lecture in a day. We do a whole series of lectures all day. And we have the last three of those Pechu Kacheris on Mamallapuram, then on Kanchipuram, and on the Cholas, we've had at this venue, and we'll have one more in December here. Varahamihira Science Forum is a more recent addition. We started this about a year and a half back. This is our lecture number 22, I believe. We have done, gone longer than we initially expected to do, which is something quite delightful. Thank you all for coming to this thing, coming to this lecture. It was started because of the idea that we needed a platform for lectures on science and science related topics that would reach the general public rather than just be there directly for the experts in that particular field of science. So to target the general public, having lectures both by professionals and amateurs. Today we have, this year we have as many professionals and amateurs. This is not usually we have three in a row by professionals. Today it's architecture by Mr. Mohan Hariharan, who's an architect. Last month it was meteorology by a meteorologist. The month before it was physics by a physics scholar, physics researcher, and so on. So without further ado, since I've introduced the forum several times, I'll just go through the list of the lectures that we've had so far, and you'd get a sense of what kind of talks you've had, what kind of lectures you're organizing. We're always looking for speakers, so you could be one of the future speakers. So we started off with that particular lecture, Antoine Lavoisier, on the origin of modern chemistry. That was about in August 2017. It was very well attended, and that was very encouraging. So the next lecture we had the next month was on, speaker is here, Badri Seshadri. He's a mechanical engineer, but he spoke about the various geometries of very interesting biological molecules, single helix, double helix, and triple helix, and their discoverers, standing in respectively for the protein, the DNA, and for collagen. And collagen was the structure, triple helix structure was discovered by G. Ramachandran, who's a scholar here. And there's a triple helix auditorium in Chennai named after this particular structure. The next one, was about bacteriophages, a biological form that few people know about, but was thought of as a popular way to eliminate diseases before antibiotics really stormed the world and changed the medical field. That was by a young speaker called K. Sivaraman, who's a regular frequent writer. He's a trainer for a lot of colleges. He's a teacher, and he writes a lot of articles in Tamil magazines and in Facebook, and now he's on a meme-making spree. He's making very interesting memes based on Tamil films to educate people about science. The next lecture was about a very famous scientist, Isaac Newton. It was again by another young person, Siddharth Chandrasekhar, an electrical engineer. He talked about Isaac Newton's writing the book Principia Mathematica de Naturalis, his Latin compilation, where he described the laws of motion, the discovery of gravity, and so on. That was followed by Professor Krishnaswamy Alladi, a grandson of the famous constitutional scholar of the same name, Alladi Krishnaswamy, and son of Alladi Ramakrishnan, who is a physicist who hosted a lot of fantastic, you know, world-class lectures by such scholars as Niels Bohr at his house in Mylapore. And it was about the series of lectures which then inspired the theoretical physics seminar at his house, inspired the formulation of the Institute of Mathematical Sciences, which is popularly known as Math Science, and he gave a lecture about it. In fact, he's written a book about it, and he's going to, Professor Krishnaswamy is going to release this book next month on the 8th of May at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation in Taramani. So if any of you are free, you can come join us for that particular book release. The one after that was an interesting lecture, very interestingly titled Atomic Theory for Alamelu Party. We wanted to reach the, you know, really going for the general public here. Akash Narayanan, young scholar doing his PhD in the University of Northern Illinois. He was here for a brief visit, and he gave a lecture on the development of atomic physics starting at the beginning of the 20th century and all the major contributions, you know, including touching upon quantum physics and relativity and from the atomic model, you know, what kind of developments have happened and so on. Lecture after that was in a slightly different field, not as popular as physics perhaps, but geology, very interesting field, inspired great biologists like Darwin. Geology is of great interest to us. The title was Wandering Rivers and Cruising Coastlines, and it started and really substantially covered the Madras Tamil Nadu region about how much rivers have changed their courses over time. Palar has, you know, wandered around, Kaveri has wandered around, what are the basins, how much the sea has retreated back and forth, not just in geological time, but even in historical times, and how some poems of some of the Tevaram poets and the period of that time, poets of that time, help us trace some of these variations. Next was by the speaker who just walked in, Venkatesh Ramakrishnan. He gave a lecture on technological advances in a traditional city. Madras, even today, is probably the most traditional of the big cities in India. But we had a development, you know, of modern technology come in the 20th century and change the nature, the structure, the geography, the culture, and several aspects of the city. And he covered various subjects, the introduction of electricity, introduction of cinema, of trains, you know, all other developments like that, you know, even dentistry and, you know, ophthalmology, things like that, the airplane and so on. Next was a war hero and a merchant sailor, K.R.A. Narasaiya, who served on the first aircraft carrier, INS Vikrant. He talked about a life molded by sea and ship. He has written a autobiographical book, Kadalodi, in Tamil. Some of you must have known it. He also wrote another wonderful book about mercantile history called Kadalvadi Vaniham. And so he spoke about his life in the sea and how his life was molded. And then he talked about some interesting experiences during the 1971 war and so on. Next, please. We had a summer camp. We will probably do this again on Indian mathematics and astronomy. Next, please. We had a wonderful talk about the monsoon, which you are all eagerly awaiting, and we may just miss a preview of which just skipped us. Shashwat gave a wonderful lecture. Again, not a person in the field, not a meteorologist, computer person who's doing something else, we find this particular theme, people studying one particular subject, working in a different field and giving talks on a third field that they're interested in, and he gave a very sweeping historical account of the Indian monsoon, not just meteorological, but also went into literature, talked about how Kalidasa had described it and how later Sangam poets of earlier age talked about it. We had a wonderful lecture by Dr. Sitar Sundar Ram about Astana Kolagalam, a mathematics book in Tamil, which you can find, by the way, in Tamil Virtual Academy's website. You can find the source book in that. It's a medieval book about 15th or 16th century. And he talked about a lot of mathematics in poetic form in Tamil, and the lecture was about it. The next was a grand lecture by a biologist that drew, it's a houseful crowd, and it was, spectacular lecture. Heritage and science very well combined, evolution, the grand heritage. He went all the way back in time to the early age of the bacteria and, came all the way to modern times. And it was a wonderful lecture by Professor Dayanandan, a biologist at the Madras Christian College. The lecture after that, next please, was by me. I gave a overview of, we had too many, almost every talk was turning out to be in English. I wanted to talk in Tamil. We couldn't find a speaker, but fortunately we had quite a few Tamil speakers since then. I wanted to talk about the astronomy and mathematics of ancient cultures. So Pandai Nagarigalin, Vaniyilum, Kanidamum, Mayan culture, Egyptian culture, the Sumerians, Greeks, and so on. Next, please. Next was probably our far and away our most popular talk. It was not only house full, it was even stage full because there are 50 people on the kids on the stage. Arvind Gupta, Padmasi winner, an IIT product from Kanpur, and he did wonderful work. He's done wonderful work taking science to kids through toys. There is a website by him, Arvind Gupta Toys. I urge you to go see it. Wonderful toys made out of very common ordinary material like sellotape and potatoes and plastic bottles and all kinds of things like that. Awesome lecture, extraordinarily popular. And after that we had a lecture on the construction of the Periyar Dam by engineer Kannan Rajendran, who is very interested and gave a lot of very interesting information about the concept. We know about it, Pennyquick, and how he changed the face of southern Tamil Nadu with the construction of this dam. But what complexities did it involve? What was the logistical problems involved? He gave a wonderful lecture on that particular subject. Next was a very interesting lecture by an important scholar, Dr. Uttara Dharirajan, professor of physics and HOD in the DG Vaishnav College. She gave a lecture about Leelavati's daughters, that is women scientists of India, and she covered several scientists, most of whom you have unfortunately not heard of. There's books about them, and you can find it on Arvind Gupta's website. You just search for them and you'll find them. We had in February, we had a lecture by, actually couple of slides are missing. We had a lecture by Dr. Velinur Ramachandran, the famous neurologist. He gave a lecture on, he gave a lecture on, the heuristics of science, about how science developed, what, how scientists think differently, how, bridging parallel different fields gives new insights into, the works on the main field that they're working on. Wonderfully attended lecture. Very fortunately, he started this year also with another lecture about Freud and his effect on modern neuroscience. It was followed by Badri Seshadri's lecture on the ribosome. The structure of the ribosome was discovered or explained by Venki Ramakrishnan, an Indian, who won the Nobel Prize a few years back in chemistry for this particular discovery, and Badri Seshadri gave a talk about it. That was followed by a lecture about the brief history of gravity by Dr. Satish Kumar Saravanan, who just left a university in Germany and has moved to a university in Brazil to start his new career. And so that was a very interesting lecture. That was followed by, next please. A meteorologist, Mr. K.V. Balasubramaniam, he gave a wonderful talk on references to climate and weather in Sangam literature. A very interesting, kind of reflecting Ramachandran, Velinur Ramachandran's talk about people from different fields influencing and, the thought process, literature and references to weather and climate. It's a very, very interesting presentation. And next, of course, we have this one by Mr. Mohan Hariharan. Architecture. Does it qualify as science? I leave that up to you. I think the speaker of the day is more than qualified to talk about it. He has been an eminent architect of the city for about 40, 45 years. He comes from an amazing family of extraordinarily accomplished people, all, you know, Padma Shri awardees and so on. He comes from a small town called Arni near Arcot. He gave us a lecture for Tamil Heritage Trust about that town, Arni. You wouldn't think that a small town like that would have so much history, but it has very interesting and very, you know, detailed history. He gave a lecture about that. He's been doing, you know, he's one of his involvements was with a reputed architect called Srinivasan. One of our friends said, Mr. Srinivasan was involved in the construction of a lot of cinema theaters, and I think Mr. Hariharan was also involved in this. And one of our friends said that in the 70s and the 80s, when people would go out in the field in the rural areas, they had not heard this word architect before. And they were asked, you know, what does an architect do? And they would explain it. And those people would say, oh, what Mr. Srinivasan does. Okay, fine. So it was kind of a very interesting take on what a coverage that man has had. And we have his student here. So without much further ado, I request Mr. Mohan Hariharan to come and give us a lecture.
Dear friends, let it take its own time. I am very happy to see my friends' faces here. One of my friends some time back asked me, in fact, I asked him whether you are attending the lecture. He asked me, where is the venue? I said, it is Tamil Virtual Academy. Then he said, oh, that's AC air conditioned auditorium. Even if the talk is going to be a bore, I don't mind spending 1.5 hours in an air conditioned auditorium. So thanks to Tamil Virtual Academy and of course Varahamiraj Science Forum, which has given me an opportunity, which is a part of Tamil Heritage Center, which encouraged me. Especially I should thank Professor Swaminathan for it. He initiated me for standing on any platform for that matter. Thank you. I would like to introduce out of his friends two important persons here because they are architecturally connected to me. He is an ex managing director of Ponds India and director of Unilever and presently a director of Polaris and many other things. And he is one of the important person in my earlier career to make myself as an architect. Gave a lot of encouragement, and I never ever believe. I wouldn't have become, but for their encouragement. I would like to thank Mr. V. Balaraman. Please, there. He is the earliest one to encourage us. And secondly, I would also like to tell you, at the fag end of my career, I am already 75 plus. My client, who became a friend also, gave me an opportunity to design a fantastic building. I have never designed a school before. And they gave me an opportunity, not only an opportunity, but they gave a full hand. But for their visionary approach, I wouldn't have done such a school, which gave us a lot of name, I would say. I would like to introduce Dr. Savita, on whose name the Savita University stands. She is the director of Savita University and also the school. Her passion is school and children. and then the way in which it has bloomed, you should have to see to believe it. As usual, a friend of mine said, Kaldondi Mandondra Kala Mudar, Mundondi Adu Katada Kalai. How is it possible? Kaldondi Mandondra Kala Mudar. Ella nama ancestors la marathu mele da irundanga. And the marathu mele irundha, even now the chimpanzees make shelters on the trees. That is, I said, that way you can connect it to anything to anybody. Architecture is a huge, very vast subject. It is extremely difficult to pinpoint something which can be discussed on architecture can be discussed by anybody else. You can criticize just like making a movie. An architect is can be compared to a director who makes a movie. It is somebody's money, you play with that, and if the project is successful, then you take the credit. And the project is not successful, you always say these actors have gone, this music director has fumbled, and the cameraman has backed out. Like that, we also say the construction guys have bungled, and then the project cost has not come in time, and so on. So the movies always they stay for a short time, but the architectural building, they stay for long, and then for you to remind you all the time. Yeah, no, model de, dilla ma, yeah. I have taken up a subject called Architecture of Gods, Kings and Mortals. To talk about architecture alone is extremely difficult, and I have combined architecture of gods. I'm not sure whether of is the correct word. It can be the architecture for gods, for kings and for mortals, or it is going to be of gods, for the gods and to the gods. Also, you can relate all three together in the way in which you want it. I have put the top picture. They are gods. They are Greek gods. I will not dare enough to put our gods because there may be some fight. So I thought I will put a Greek god there and also an Ispate king there. He's a cloud diamond king, okay. And our common man is there to represent. These all three are totally combined, I mean interconnected in all respects. Whether God created man or not, there is no question of debating on that. But the interconnection between God, the king, and the common man is existing forever, but from time immemorial. Yes. Thank you. And yeah, I would like to first introduce my favorite architects. That is the way I would do it. Kindly go ahead. Can you imagine a creature not longer than about 5-6 inches could make a fort on its own with its own fins? And perhaps I would say one of the greatest architect is this fish. Before going to that, I would like to tell you the title part of it. I have borrowed the title from Mr. Venkatesh, who has written a book called Gods, Kings and Slaves. With his permission or without his permission, I have borrowed it partially, I would say. So coming back to my favorite architects, I would like to tell you the other architects. Well, before coming to that, some time back I think Mr. Gopu asked, there are Aimbarum Kapiyangal, Navaratnangal, Mushtadigjangal, and the Madri, சித்திரத்துக்கு உண்டா, ஐம்பெரும் சித்திரங்கள் உண்டான்னு கேட்டார். அந்த மாதிரி அது இருக்கா இல்லையாங்க அப்புறம் நான் இன்னும் பார்க்கல. பட் அதே மாதிரி யூ கேன் ஆஸ்க் இன் ஆர்கிடெக்சர், இதர ஐம்பெரும் ஐம்பெரும் பில்டிங்ஸாக இருக்குங்களா அப்படின்னு கேட்டால், ஐ வில் சே செவன் ஒண்டர்ஸ் ஆஃப் த வேர்ல்டு. வாட் ஆர் தே? மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் தம் ஆர் ஆர்கிடெக்சர். அவுட் ஆஃப் கப்பல் ஆஃப் ஒன் ஆர் டூ யூ கேன் சே எய்தர் கிரேட் வால் ஆஃப் சைனா, த பிரமிட், ஆர் வாட் எல்ஸ். ஐ ஹவ் சீன் அட்லீஸ்ட் ஃபைவ் ஆஃப் தெம். ஐ வுட் சே டவர், லீனிங் டவர் ஆஃப் பீஸா, அஃப்கோர்ஸ் அவர் ஓன் தாஜ்மஹால், அண்ட் அஃப்கோர்ஸ் ஐ எம் லீவிங் பீஸா டவர் ஆஃப் பீஸா அண்ட் ஸோ ஆன் அண்ட் ஸோ. அவுட் ஆஃப் த வண்டர்ஸ் ஆஃப் த வேர்ல்டு இட் இஸ் ஆர்கிடெக்சர் தட் இஸ் த மோஸ்ட் இம்பார்ட்டண்ட், இட் ஆக்குபைஸ் த மோஸ்ட் இம்பார்ட்டண்ட் பார்ட். ஐ ஹவ் நோ டவுட் ஆன் தேட். And then, well, I let me see the other favorite architects. Can you see this? No, earlier. Why do you, I have not explained about it. Look at this. This is an anthill. This anthill has got a colony here. This after all is less than a half an inch. It can construct more than 200 times of its height to a great skyscraper. பறவை கண்டான் விமானம் படைத்தான் அப்படின்னு கண்ணதாசன் சொல்கிறார். ஏன் எறும்புனை படைத்தான் ஸ்கைஸ்கேப்பர் படைத்தான் சொல்லலை, தெரியல, ஐ எம் நாட் ஷியூர் வை. பட் யூ கேன் இஸ் அ தெர்மல் இன்சுலேஷன், இன்சுலேட்டட், ஹைலி ப்ரொடெக்டிவ், அண்ட் இட் குட் தே குட் மேக் அ பியூட்டிஃபுல் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் இஸ் கால் ஆன்டியல். அண்ட் லுக் அட் திஸ், திஸ் இஸ் ஐ வுட் சே எ போயம் இன் ஆர்கிடெக்சர். இட் இஸ் நாட் த ஷேப், இட் இஸ் நாட் த structure, but it whole things is like a poem. Architecture in poem is something remarkably safe, and then it is whether it allows air at the same time doesn't allow water to come in. That's a beautiful architecture of the weaver bird. Look at this, the most expensive of silk thread is a cocoon. They can do it with which is going to be a costly affair, I mean, stronger than steel wires. And my favorite other beaver bird, it can find out its way if there, if they can construct a dam. They are the engineers in the otherwise. Even it knows the water level comes up, it can go to a higher level and stay, and then make a best shelter out of it. What do we understand from this? An architect has got to be an artist like this. It has got to be a strong, it has got to be a safe one, and then he must be an engineer too. Let's go to the next one. But who is the greatest architect, or what is the greatest architecture you call? Look at this. Can you imagine any other greater architecture than this, the universe? I don't think anybody can imagine, anybody can do it, or anybody can repeat it, or we put Einstein's way, whether it can be neither be created nor be destroyed. You have any questions? Yeah. Architecture of the galaxy. See, that's very nice of him. I will come back to you at the end of it. There is a galaxy which is coming up on the earth, okay? Right. I don't think anything can imagine, once of all, such a magnitude. I cannot imagine anything about 10 zeros after 1. How do you expect me to think of a billion galaxies, billion stars, and out of which we are going to pick out one solar system, one planet of Earth, and then I have to talk about the architecture about it. How is it possible? Anyhow, let's... before coming to that, I would like you to understand whether... have you ever seen a plant incomplete? A small plant, when it comes about 4 inches height, will you say that it is incomplete? Or when it grows to about 2 feet height, will you say that the plant is incomplete? Or when it goes to a great height, will you say this again incomplete? Every time you see it, it is always complete. This is one of the important points for an architect to understand. Every time it grows, it has got to be a complete one. I have the same way human beings too. When they are such kids or a young boy like this, can you find any imperfection with them? I don't think so. They all the time they are perfect somehow. That is the way in which architecture has got to be. That's what the great people say. Well, whether we practice or not is a different matter. Even an old age, an old couple, they look graceful. We see quite a lot of people. That is how one has to gracefully, even architecture has got to do that. Here, let us come back to again the creation. According to the Hindu mythology, there's a big bang by great Brahma. From the big bang, the universe comes in. As he said, the galaxies are somewhere there, and then it may come to a higher level. But Brahma created the bang, but he is the one, is the divine architect, Vishwakarma. Even now you can see there are a lot of pujas and very many communities doing it. It's called Ayudha Puja. But his work seems to be, there are a lot of stories about him which I am not going into detail. However much, there is a small thing to say, he created himself, I believe. That's what they say. I don't know, is it possible? He's a god of all the persons. When you say it is in Hindu India, we have been talking about it. What about in other countries? For example, in Egypt, there's a god for architecture. Well, he is not he, but he is a she. She is a goddess called, in Egypt he is called Pita, whereas a Greek goddess is Hestia. He is a she goddess. In Chinese too, they have various gods for architecture, but they are all mainly for the directions. Each direction represents an animal. For example, east represents a blue dragon, west represents a white tiger, north represents a tortoise, south represents a phoenix. But the goddess of architecture is called Shangti. That is how it has been done. But the creation of universe in Old and New Testaments are very well known. They also say they do not show as the God, but the God's Son has come. And we all know the famous word, "Let there be light." Yeah, next we... The myths are facts. We have got to think about it. In fact, I am not very well qualified to talk about this because I am not very concerned, know the details of Hindu or Indian way of thinking, if there is one you call it. You have a Vastu Purush here. It has been mentioned from Rig Veda's time, and in the Varaha Mitra, which has been named up this forum, in his Brihat Samhita, mentions about the grammar for it. And if there is a grammar, it has been mentioned by quite a number of people. In Manasara Silpa system, Shastra, they describe how it has got to be designed by way of the figures. For example, Dandakam or Chadurmukam or Swastik is the type of figures based on which the buildings have got to be come in. And then in Bharata Muni's Natya Shastra, he has mentioned how an auditorium has to be designed, how the size of the auditorium is to be done, on what basis. And I was always thinking he is only a Mayan, nothing connected to Mayan architecture of Mexico. But our Mayan, he is a Mamuni Mayan, he is supposed to be a greatest architect who created very many places. I think he is the one who did Sri Lanka. He is the one. Dwaraka also. Well, do you know there is a memorial building for him in Chennai? It's very close to Mahabalipuram. There is a memorial building in which there is a library. There are quite a number of interesting books are there. It is being run by Sapati, Ganapati Sapati is running that architecture school. This is an interesting Purochana is the one who comes in Mahabharata. I don't know how many of you, most of the people who are 60 plus would have seen House of Wax movie, in which the building is constructed out of wax. In Mahabharata, the Pandava, they go to an Arakku Maligai. That Arakku Maligai's architect is none other than the Purochana, who is a close friend of Duryodhana. The Arakku Maligai has been constructed in such a way, you would never believe that it is made out of something that is going to melt in fire. Then of course you have Manayadisastram. Manayadisastram based on various numbers as well as units, which gives you. Again, coming back to Vasu, perhaps our Vasu books, about 10 books, more than 10 books have written Mr. Venkatesh, who would know much better. But this Vasu was originally an asura who has been pinned on the ground. I'm not well versed, but anyhow I'm just giving a story. When he was pinned down on the earth, the positions have been fixed, whether his head portion of it, he is actually facing down in this, and then his legs are put in position, and then his also on the direction of north, south and east and west, and the number of divisions based on which one has to fix up your buildings. This question of direction itself, I do not know at all. When in an universe where the sun goes in a helical way all the time towards some direction, and all the planets also rotating all the time in a helical portion, whether north, which side we could look into it, I do not know. Maybe some physics man can say that. Next. Before going to this, this Manayadisastram, they say, it has been very funnily said, when Mapala Uruku Ponarna, Enga Ponon Chanarna, I believe when he goes to Mamanar's house, he must face his head in west. When he goes to outstation, he must put his head on east, so that he has to get up early in the morning and then go for work. I don't know how far it is true. And when he wants to have a romantic area, he must go to the south side and have it, because anga nalla kaathu varuma. Anyhow, coming back to this, I said myths and facts. I said myths we do not know. You have to have a belief, and once you have a belief, once you believe, certain belief need not be backed up by science, and so it goes on. Then there are some other facts we find in from the ancient time of Euclid. Euclid, a great Greek mathematician, in 300 BC, you can see he has written a book, several books, out of which Elements, he talks about a golden ratio. This golden ratio is totally come from them. As a grammar of architecture, there are scales for everything. For example, you have a scale for sound, you can measure it in decibels. There is a length, you can measure it in the terms of miles or kilometers. You have sound in decibels, I said. Do you have any scale for beauty? Can you measure it? They say, yes, it can be done. What did they say? They found most of the things found in nature, which are extremely beautiful, they try to find why it is beautiful. Then when they find that the certain proportion has brought beauty to it, this is what the earliest one, he says, what he calls is a golden mean. This I am not going in detail, but you can see, you will learn about it. A square out of which this is the central portion, this is a diagonal, is a root 2, root 5 by 2, which has been turned to a radius. This rectangle seems to be a perfect rectangle. It is seen everywhere, they say, wherever you see in nature. But he is not the one who, he just found out this perfect rectangle, but it has got a value of y, which is an irrational number. And again, to put it in a nutshell, at a later date, he found out, that is, Fibonacci found a series in which, by which he has given the square, as what we saw a square, which can be within this. This is how I believe a snail's shell is also made, a conch has been made, and this series is a very extremely interesting series, and many of you would have known about it. And then we have Virtues, who has been 80-70 BC in his book called De Architectura, describes about man's movements, and then he finds the proportion, and ultimately it is Da Vinci who made a Virtuous Man, in which the proportions are given. It is exactly in the same way of this famous golden ratios. And in the latest architect, of modern architects, has started doing it. It's not only modern architect, they say the ancient architects also have done it, which I will show you some of the example. But of later, when Le Corbusier, as late as in 1900, he found a man called Modular Man, based on which he did everything, including your sitting chairs, the windows, doors, and huge buildings. Next one. Here is some of the golden ratio they have been used. They say this is a New York UN building. Each one, I believe, is a golden ratio square. If you go back to old one, the Parthenon is in 438 BC. The proportion what we saw there in a square, bigger square, it goes to a Fibonacci series. And then they say even Taj Mahal is like that. I found most of the buildings have been, whether they have been brought under golden ratio or really they are in golden ratio, is one of the biggest question mark. They say this Tanjavur Brihadeeswar temple, they put a plan and then show this is a golden rectangle. They somehow arrived at on a golden rectangle, which I am not sure how to arrive at a golden rectangle after putting the building. But that seems to be the case. There is hundreds of things they show. I will show you some of the interesting golden ratio. Come on, next one. You see, this is the DNA. They say this follows a golden ratio by which your DNA has been made. Somebody has to say that. And then the modern companies taken it as literally as their gospel truth, and then made it a Toyota signal on an iCloud signal is totally to the proportion of 1:1.618. That is a golden one. Can you see the Disney's one? Can you see this symbol here and this symbol here? This is a phi. They have introduced it there, thinking that will bring a golden shower on them. That's well, the most modern automobiles have been designed with the golden ratio. Some time back I was talking about how plants grow. Plants have a lot of shapes. They are mostly in geometrical shapes, conical, spherical, triangle, and several shapes, but none of them are perfect triangles or perfect spheres or orange or oblique. They are all routed to the nearest area. Does it mean no man's hand is, all fingers are one line, your nose is not a double barrel gun? And why is it been designed like that? We don't know. They say that is how it has got to be designed. Either proportion of the man, and some of the great temples in South India, they say when a man lies down on the floor, the whole thing is placed on that. Nature gives us that following a geometrical pattern, but not following a geometrical pattern. In other words, they have given an ergonomic shape, whichever you find it extremely useful shapes. So we say that architect has to understand this and then go in for ergonomic shapes, not merely go in for the rectangles like this. And one of the earlier movies, slides I had shown, this golden ratio of Parthenon. If you notice this, all the diagrams are two-dimensional flat diagrams. Can you ever see a building like that? Unless you stand exactly in the center level, even then top and bottom portion will never be same. Then how do you say that rectangle is one what you see is so good? Whether this golden rectangle is really a myth or a fact, you've got to say. You can never see a single building in one line. Single perspective also has got the three dimension. If the three dimensional value is not been taken, well, then why is that the golden ratio has been glorified? I am not sure. And then a natural view or the perspective views. Pardon? Yeah. Yeah. Right. That is agreed. But that you see it only in a plane, a line of that. Whereas in a three-dimensional view, you can never view the whole part and the square part of it. It is always you see it from the side, or even if you directly see from the straight line, the distortion is there. By the perspective, the distortion is maximum, and so you can unless you on a drawing, you can never see a golden rectangle. It can never visualize that way. But this distortion of perspective, the Greeks have found there is a distortion. So what do we do? When you see in perspective a pillar, they have made slightly larger on the higher side, so that when you look into it, it looks straight. That you can see about in Parthenon, it's about 2.5 inches. They have straightened it out, made it bigger, so that it finally gives a flat look instead of making it a conical one. So that is how they made it slightly wider to give an optical illusion. Yeah, and of course the ziggurats were given differently, but this proportion of the pillar itself has been distorted so that you get a clear view. Like some of the cricket pitches, if you have seen, you will see exactly the symbol has been correctly done. But if you go near, it will be a distortion one. Or a three-dimensional view on a streetscape. Now you see a lot of artists do exactly make a lot of like a pit, and then they walk through. But from a distance, if you see, it is not a pit actually. It is a distorted figure. So that sort of illusionary effects they have brought in. They thought by visually you have got to make it correct, even though by nature it is not going to be so. Well, coming back to this, this is one of the most important graph which I made. Not I have made, but after trying to make it, then I found somebody from Japan. They have done an excellent job. And normally nobody in auditorium goes through a graph, and then it has got to be passed on. But I'll let you know, this gives an entire history of human beings, giving a framework of comparative civilization. How this pink one shows an urban life, and others, and finally the last thin line is the scientific one, which I will talk about it. But I am showing this. Those who are interested, we can discuss about this later, but this gives the is in a fantastic diagram which I have followed. skip pannitingla varudhu slide. This is the seven lamps of architecture. Okay, Munal Pocha, I have not seen the the earliest grammar which we talking about the beauty part of it. The famous John Ruskin in 1849 has given his own grammar, but being a theologist and then mostly following Christianity, he based on his principles of sacrifice, truth, power, memory, beauty, life, obedience, which each one has got his own detail of how it has got to be designed. He has put a grammar on this. This is one of the earliest one on grammar. Please go to the next one. This is the thing which I said, which I'll talk to you about shortly. The history of man is, I would say, it follows six revolutions. Architecture is follows the history, and these six elevations, I would say, one is an anthropic. In other words, this is a physical change of man from ape to human beings. This has happened on the earth throughout simultaneously. Whereas the next one was during that period, man was an ape, he becoming this is basically a physical change. Then the agricultural revolution came. This is as early as 9000 to 3000 BC. This is basically an economic change. This has happened in many places in differently, but to give you some of the examples, I would call it as the first industrial revolution. They have started know how to cultivate, so it moved to the riverside, and then they know how to make food or create. They know how to cultivate. So cultivation means they had able to find tools. When they started finding the greatest invention we call wheels. And this is the first industrial revolution, you can put it on to say. They have started making clothes, they have started building small buildings. At that time, they found new varieties of food. For example, in Mesoamerican, the corn and maize have been invented or discovered. Even now we have famous corn chips throughout South Indian, you get it. And then China found the rice. Southeast Asians, all the roots have come into food. And India had beans and barleys and rice. Africa had cereals. They say cereals sometime back, I don't know, I had been to an Ethiopian restaurant. They serve what is called injera. I don't know how many of you have tasted injera. It is something like a rava dosa. They say it's made out of an Ethiopian cereal, and then they ferment it, I believe, and then make it like a dosa. It is an interesting one. When I saw this in Africa, is the one who invented, I was reminded of that. This first industrial revolution followed on to an urban revolution. This urban revolution has happened almost simultaneously in various places the man has started forming cities from the agricultural side. Then he has started cities, and then city states have come into existence. Then the tribal man has become a king, and king royal authority has been implemented. And then riverside civilizations have come into being. You know the famous Euphrates and Tigris, the Mesopotamian civilization, or in Indus it is an industrial civilization, or in China it's Chinese civilization and Egyptian Nile along the Nile is an Egyptian civilization. Yellow River is a Chinese civilization here. This has brought in a settled life, and then architecture started coming slowly in a very systematic manner. The next resolution is a spiritual revolution. This has mainly happened in the Middle East area, even though the earlier spirituality in India is very early, you know, started perhaps in Upanishad's time. But subsequently, India found various other masters, including Buddha, Mahavira. In the Middle East, the Old Testament and the New Testament came in, and China, Jesus Christ came in, and then Islam gave birth. Earlier than to that area, Zoroastrians were there. So these are all happened almost simultaneously. Then the spiritual revolution took place, and then it has changed the face of man. In the sense, it is happened almost simultaneously, and now this classes have started. Then the class, and then religious divisions were there. The original divisions have now been established. Then comes the scientific revolution. The scientific revolution is mostly after, even before industrialization came into being, and during many discoveries. Science has come mainly from Europe. It has started from Europe and started going. All these other areas have not started on the scientific revolution. Then this has brought a great change. From agriculture, it has brought people from to villages to cities, and you know this. I don't have to talk much about the science. I don't have to talk much about the science, the scientific revolution, because everything is now whatever we have. How we would have never been talking on a phone like this. This revolution has taken place and then brought a globe together. The other things have been localized, but this has come to bring all culture together, civilization together. Sometimes you fight for your culture to keeping intact, but now it has become a modern, amalgamated culture. That's what happened to architecture also. Then, having come to that, now we see the good and bad effects of scientific revolution. The bad one, as again we have got to go back to what we call environmental revolution. This is the brief history of revolution, and this architecture follows the same thing. Can you go to the next one? I would briefly talk about what the influencing factors in architecture. Climate, of course, these are the basic things. Climate, geography, culture, religion with caste, or sometimes the racial, socio-economic, class and political. Then one of the most influencing factor is imagination and forms. And then of course rules and regulations influence architecture. And of course, if you ask a common man, he will say architecture, caste is the most important. This is what he is going to say. These are the influencing factors which is basic. You have got to have the combo of several things here. The combination of these things will give you, but there's some of the basic things remain as it is. While these factors are influencing architecture, ultimately it comes down to cost, and you have a priority for sometimes. You give more cost to something which is not required. It depends upon the priority you give. When I talk about climate, when I said climate, people construct, now the climate concept has gone, everything is being air conditioned, where is the question of climate? Naturally earlier they have been saying all the time you need air, you need light, and then you take your construction like this. Now this has become a global architecture, and they simply forget about climate. When I say climate, I just remember in my town, Arani, Jagir has constructed a palace in which he had got fireplaces and chimneys. That is how they looked into client. Even now it is there. Yeah. Now the materials in architecture are from the basic earth and mud. From the man who has found earth and mud, still there is a special architectural architects working on earth and mud. The mud is one of the insulating materials. In desert architecture, we have mud structures that has got its own limitations, and then it can vary. So there is earth is being used, mud is being used, then you know wood is one of the naturally available, extensively used in most of the Western Europe's and Nordic Scandinavian countries. They use only wood which has been used, and stone is one of the strongest material which originally been being difficult to make smaller size and put it in structure. They have not been using, but you know this Mahendra Pallavan, he said his temple want to live forever, so he constructed his temple in stone and brick is one of the most versatile improvement on the earth and mud combined together. They made brick. That is why one of the main reason brick building gives you an earthy effect, goes along with that. We have metal. When the discovery of metal long back, steel was extensively used, which is one of the most flexible material. Still, other use of bamboo. Bamboo's use has not been fully utilized, but you know the bamboo strips have been used as a reinforcement for concrete. In many of the places in Assam and other areas, walls have been provided with bamboo, with making it a wall. This bamboo architecture has not been fully exploited. And then textiles have been used. You would have seen most of the old circus tents or an old pole, which has been bamboo. And then the entire roof will be in a canvas, which is a textile architecture, is an interesting architecture. And concrete is the most versatile one. Which has been concrete as going on various changes from Roman age, then finally it has come to what we call a reinforced cement concrete. Is a most plastic material. You can shape to any material, any size, any form, which gives you last longing one. Now the plastic has come into place. Even carbon fiber has been used in the building. Some of the facades have been provided with carbon fiber, and We create so much of waste. We started making buildings out of waste and organics. Next one, please. I have given an example of how this is a mud building in a desert in Africa. Whereas this is a stabilized earth block. The earth is made to a block, and then a structure has been done. Just I have given not a small structure, it's a big structure that can withstand. You see a timber one, and this is a bamboo one. Can you see the shape of the building, which can do wonderfully, you can do any way you want it. This is a concrete structure. You know perhaps this is a Baha'i temple in Delhi. It has been more maximum plasticity of concrete has been used to the best. You see the textile, and then here you see this is the glass which have been used extensively for the building, and you see here there's a brickwork, one of the beautiful brick temples throughout North India you can see, and especially in West Bengal. And this is the glass fabric, glass fiber, which has been used in facades. People think that architecture is just making a facade. There is another item, just like changing your dress, pant or a shirt. People think architecture is nothing but doing a building, but unfortunately it is not so. You have got to undergo a training of planning, how to make man movement and material movement, and how we do to make the life easier is the way in which one has to design. Coming back to this, I have given coming to the shelters, architecture of gods, as early as 1000 years back, is constructed in a temple of this magnitude using stone. But you see another temple here is been done recently in Vellore, perhaps it is. It's almost same thing, but he has put a cover on it with a golden cover. This temple architecture in India has not changed much. They have been following either Shilpa Shastra or Vastu Shastra or any other Shastra, but basically it remains same. God has been staying in the same way. There is a big difference between Hindu temples and other abode of God. In Hindu temples, God resides. He stays. He sleeps. He eats. He takes bath daily, and then he goes around. And then that is how a Hindu temple lives. Whereas in other, say in Islam or other area, Islam doesn't require any idols there. So they need only a place to just to worship their six worships. Say they need a huge shelter. And Christianity, they congregate. And then the priest passes on various things to them. That is a major difference between Hindu, Christianity, and Islam. Here I am just trying to tell you that in temple architecture has not changed much. Next one, please. Here you see, you would be easily recognized. There are hundreds of beautiful churches throughout the world. I have seen St. Paul, St. Peter, the beautiful Notre Dame de Paris. And then, of course, in India, you have various one. Here is the one which is St. Thome, the church which has undergone a lot of changes. But can you imagine, this is a church which is done in 1955 with the famous architect Le Corbusier. This, you must see the interior of that. It's a fantastic one. People have accepted that the change of forms in Christianity has been almost 100%. You can do anything you want, provided you have some basic things. Let us, so the change in churches has been accepted. God has accepted there the changes. Come to next one. Even Islam. I would specifically this blue mosque, which is not really a original mosque, is a Byzantine architecture in which originally this was a Christian church which has been converted to a mosque. This is one of the supposed to be the largest mosque there. It is in 1615 in Istanbul is there. But have you seen this modern mosque in Germany? They are also prepared to accept this structure. They were able to accept. Perhaps that is why I said in Hinduism they don't want to change the temple, because he lives there, he doesn't want to have any renovation or changes, whereas others have simply straight away accepted. Next one, please. Coming back to the kings, we have finished on the gods. Before coming to this, gods have also has their representatives throughout the world. There are a lot of godsmen. They have their own architecture. If we go to Sadhguru in Valiangiri, he has got his own architecture. Perhaps he has got the largest brick dome next to Golgumbas. And then Osho has his own empire, where he constructed in Pune his own style of architecture. And then Hare Krishna movement is there, the big cult. Throughout the world, they have their own type of architecture. They do still have. Brahma Kumaris have their, I think, headquarters in Mount Abu. They have their own type of architecture. Why, even Puttaparthi Sai Baba's structure. All these godmen have their own architecture. Their own philosophies. So God has given permission for them to go ahead with their architecture, and then they thrive on their own architecture. So architecture is not only brick and structure, it has got addition of various other things involved. A gentleman walked into one of my buildings. He said, the minute I entered, I have vibrations. I was a bit shocked because it was designed for everything. I said, it is designed for a seismic force. You shouldn't have any anything like that, and it is quite safe. He said, no, it is not like that. I said, the minute I enter, I have a positive energy inside. I do not know about this positive energy. Then I understood, oh, it may be. When I say this, then I understood this positive energy, the cosmic energy or the X-ray energy, whatever energy, they all go around everywhere. And then the simplest thing I understood was it is to give joy when you enter, or when you enjoy. Architecture is nothing but an improvement of structure which will give you joy. So that is how I understood. Sometime back I I told you about the pyramids. In the pyramids time, it's a place for future of the pharaohs. I had an opportunity to go inside. And to go inside is a bit gloomy. Whether that is a negative architecture, I do not know. There is a negative architecture is there. Sometime back, they say, like our Arakku Maligai, which has been a negative architecture, you should not live there. Somebody was asking, why our parliament cannot be designed like that? Why do you face the ruling party? You must face the other side so that they don't fight. That's this bringing very negativity in the architecture. So they said you can construct a negative architecture also. They bring in a bad mood. When they enter inside, they should have a mood. I was talking about when I visited Valley of Death in Luxor. I had an opportunity to go inside a basement of King Ramesses VI has been lying down there. The guard was very strict. You cannot carry any cell phone. You cannot photograph, do anything. So I was walking around with my iPad. I used to normally say, do you have a camera? They say, I don't have. You have cell phone? I say, no. But I have iPad. Yeah, it's all right. You can go, they say. That man was looking around, and then almost all people have gone out, and then the gentleman asked me, are you Indian? I said, Indian. The minute he noticed me, and then almost all people have gone, he said, they cannot take a photograph. Then I said, you like Amitabh Bachchan? He said, yes, I like. Do you want Amitabh Bachchan? He said, yes. Then I immediately picked out a photograph of Amitabh Bachchan. I had taken it, with which he has autographed. I took it from the net and then gave it to him. He said, now you can take photograph. That is how. Then, why I am trying to tell you, it is a very gloomy place. That mummy or whatever it is been lying there, it is giving me it is not a very pleasant affair. So, negativity in architecture can create, whether it is because of the mood, or is because of the color, or when I visited in Poland, Kharkov, if I remember correctly, Osnek, area in which, in fact, my wife said I will not be able to pass on beyond this because it is so much of negativity is there. You feel as though you are crying. You can see the heaps of pajamas. You can see heaps of chapels. All the victims of Nazi concentration camp. You would have seen the movie called Pajamas, Missing Pajamas. Schindler's, right? Other one is a pajamas. Yeah, it is actually happening. You can't say there. It is the emotion that is combined along with that. You go to your own native place, even if it is a dirty place, even if it is a dilapidated building, if you are born there, you feel like seeing it. You enjoy it. That is so I found architecture alone is not the factor for deciding a negativity or a positivity. It is your thinking that makes you a positive architecture or negative architecture. But it can create a difference in architecture. Some of the world famous architects when they made museums, especially on concentration, to remind the Nazi concentration thing, they made in such a way that it's very difficult to walk in through. You find it extremely dark colored, you can't enter. And then they said, the architect said, I want you to feel the same way where how the prisoners felt. This is a way in which they have been designing influence of architecture. Here the luxury of kings, you can see the castles. The kings have been constructing castles, forts, and then palaces. You can see this Mysore Maharaja's palace here. It's a Louvre palace here, which has been now converted to, and the Great Pyramid, which I've been talking about. You have to go inside. It's mostly in a structural marvel. And then we go inside. The great king who wanted his next life, he amassed so much of gold in it. The only thing I could gather is metallurgy must have been in a great the peak of his time, because of such beautiful ornaments have been done there. Here this interesting museum, Louvre, it is maybe about 1,000 rooms are there. It is for a king to live. He constructed for himself, and now it has become a museum. In front of that you see a pyramid there. It's very interestingly, this 3,000-4,000 years pyramid has been brought into a transparent pyramid. It has been done by architect A.M. Pai. Earlier the people used to roam around all these areas. So the president of France wanted to make something better, so he invited I.M. Pai to give an area where people can enter. He made a translucent, transparent pyramid, and you go down there and then enter the museum without disturbing the surrounding area. This has been, of course, there is a lot of criticism. One of the criticism is that you preserve dead people in a pyramid. Why do you have this? And then it has got 666 panels, which is a devil's number. They say, why do you have it there? So such is the thing. I would say this king's palace now, that has all gone. Here it has become a pyramid. This has become a visitor's area. If we go to Rajasthan, hotels, they all become hotels and resorts. You can have, if you pay 300 rupees, you can have tea with Maharaja. When I went there to Udaipur, he invited us for a tea. He said, 300 rupees is a long table in which people, all mostly foreigners, they come and sit. At the end of it, Maharaja with his turban, with his tail, comes there. He says, now we all can have tea. This is a 20 rupees worth of tea. You have 3,000, he earns a lot. That is how it has been there. Of course, North India, they have the way how to keep the palaces and make money. Here we have, you would have seen Arani Jagi's palace, which is going to dogs. Well, next one. Well, I have said something about the gods, something about the kings. I have not covered fully, but we will come back to ourselves. That is mortal beings. The mortals are the one important people who have been giving everything to the king and or to the god. You go and put donations in the one, and unfortunately he lives like this. The one ultimately they made perhaps this is the largest slum in Dharavi, and this one is a modern slum where you put the people here on top of a building where this is a fisherman's slum, which has been converted to a multi-storied. He has no place to put spread his net. He has no place to dry his fish, and so on. And then this is how we have been living earlier, the row houses. The row houses, you have been living like this. It's a very intimate space for you to have a nice life. You have got a tile roof with a thinnai. And then even if you go to Varanasi now, the streets are narrow, but it is lively. If you go to our Mint Street, it is so lively. If you go to Rotterdam or Amsterdam, such a narrow areas they still have. They have intimacy, you have a scale, and then people have got what is called safety is there. You have a row houses, you all live in it, you know who is your neighbor, who will have a social life is much better in living in such areas. Unfortunately, when you go to a large bungalow, you do not know who is on the other side, or the other compound, you may not know it. The social life has changed such a way. This is another concrete jungle. This I am just giving you an example of, you got to think about it. As an architect, we have a lot more solutions, but there are people who have to implement it. From king, the gods, the kings, and men are there. But I tell you, most of the public buildings have been handled by government or others, are all for normal human beings. You take, for example, schools, you take museums, high court, where people go around. You have now the status symbol, not status symbol, where you would like to go is a mall. The architecture has now become an amalgamation architect. You can't differentiate between one mall to other mall. You have no distinct style of mall. You will only outwardly you change it, or you add a couple of cinema theaters or a couple of restaurants there. So the designated or the architecture has become a global village, and architecture has become an amalgamated architecture from the what we had the individual identity. Still, the keeping culture intact, you want to have your own identity. If you go to US, you still have this temple there where they give you, most of the people go there mainly because they give you nice prasadam, which is about $5 you get good puriyodare, and so on. Well, coming to the next thing, you will see this either Chettinad, you will say this is Rendugattu, or if you go to Kerala, you will say Nalugattu building. Well, this is a courtyard building. But it is neither in India, it is nowhere around that. It is one of the Roman building. This is how Romans have been building earlier. You have the earliest apartment building by Romans in Rhodes. We have a huge courtyard. They too have courtyards here. I was thinking all the time, very long time, that it's only the South India we've been enjoying the courtyards, which is one of the most social area where you have adjacent houses have been close to each other. You have a living space inside where you live in, not you live out. Now the things have changed, but the earliest architecture itself has been provided with a courtyard. Courtyard theme has been not new to our place. Next one, please. This is how as a people we have now come to celebrate as a parliament. This parliament, perhaps next month we will know the fate of people who have, want to have their own representatives. Next one, please. I talked about these people, but the earliest architects who had given scope for how a city should grow. He is the one earliest one to call for a garden city with a satellite around. The satellite cities around which we have been thinking around in Tamil Nadu now. As early as in 1898, he had his structure. He had made this garden city. It is still there. It has got. It has changed something. But this is what he has said tomorrow. It's influenced by a utopian novel, but Howard's book is still holds good to have an utopian city. Next one, please. This is one of the most important person, I would say, in the planning of architecture. Sir Patrick Geddes, he had interacted with Darwin, Tagore, Mahatma Gandhi, and Jagdish Chandra Bose. Can you imagine in 1915 and 18, he said the most important thing before designing a place is to observe the why, how will they do it. We had our surveys being done physically, but not about who they are, what they are, and how they are. He said most of the town planners put straight lines and then demolish all these areas, demolish that areas. And then he said, that is not the way to look into it. You understand, he brought the observation technique of civil survey. And then he said, conservative surgery. Now it has become, surgery has become very common. We have selective surgery in army, but naval surgical strikes. Likewise, you have got to do surgery, not cutting across the entire limbs or fingers, but to take remove the bottleneck. It's a very interesting history he has written. He is in Kanpur. He is very close to Maharaja. He said, one day I would like to be a Maharaja for a day. He gives a, say, yes, you can do what you want. He said, before we celebrate Diwali in a great style. On the day they bring Ravana and then burn him in the public place. So he said, this year you cannot do your deities will not come through your place if the place is dirty. The indoor at that time was with plague, lot of rats and everything. People have been very reluctant to do that. He brought in and said, unless you clean your areas, you put them, we are prepared to clean. We will rent you all the facilities, bring all the things out, and then only the goddess will come through your place. People have been helped by so many Maharaja's people. All the dirt have come. There is, according to him, there's about 6,000 loads of dirt has been removed. The rats had no place. They all ran out of the place. And then they all been brought to a central end of the area. And then they had a pageant, just like we have in Independence Day or Republic Day. He brought the largest size of malaria mosquito, large size of locust, and large size of rats, everything on a huge floats, and then brought it to first. And then secondly, he brought the cleaning things, the planting trees, like that. He brought the pageants in a grand manner. Ultimately, he brought the scavengers. They brought in, they put a turban with a broom. Everything, they came in along with that. Then there came the Raja in his with his thing, and the deity came, and finally the people band, everything's walked in. People were extremely happy. They were earlier very skeptical about Geddes improving the area. The entire area was cleaned, and then they said, "Your Ravana is here. You can now burn it." The entire dirt was being burnt, and then they have got rid of their plague that way. He is one who has done that. I'm sorry, he has gone back. So you will not believe it. He has given a way how to plan our cities like Coimbatore, Trichy, Golconda, Lucknow. He has got a plan. He has given a plan how to improve that, which we have never seen it. It is in the books only. We have never seen, and how to do it, we have never gone into it. Next one, please. Here I am not going to talk much of the, is it time now? Yeah. He's one of the greatest architects who has brought in what we call form follows function and an organic architecture. I have seen his building, one of the most beautiful building. Next one, please. He has a church here. Can you imagine? He has designed a church. This is one of the single room house. Even for a small man, he has done it. This is one of the revolutionary Johnson Wax building in which the mushroom architecture has been there. This is the interior. Next one, please. This is the supposed to be most beautiful building. This is called Falling Water, where he brought in nature inside. The river goes inside the house and then comes out. It is on a small mountain. Part of the mountain is inside. You live inside a house where you see when initially brought it to the client, he was not very happy. Then finally he said, I must hear the sound of the river, the falling water constantly. So he designed it such a way. Then he became the earliest one to have a cantilever slab, a concrete slab of 16 feet. I had an opportunity to go inside. You got to pay $40, man. This is the most revolutionary architect who brought by Nehru to plan a city called Chandigarh. His earlier Frank Lloyd Wright brought form follows function, organic architecture. He says house is a machine to live in. You have got to design just like an automobile. How you design, you have to have a safety, you have got to have a good view, you should be nice looking, you should have a comfort. It should be the way in which you have to go to design your house. He said, God has created and don't meddle with that. This is what you have put. So he put all his buildings on stilts and saying, don't disturb the, have the flat roof and have the garden on top of it. He has, he has given the most important of his architecture to the people, or highest is the High Court, the Assembly and the Secretariat. This is what he has made Chandigarh the greatest one. This famous manhole has been designed by Le Corbusier, which was recently sold in an auction for 20 lakhs. Can you imagine that? They have been getting rid of all the old furniture that was selling in New York in auction. This went for it. Then they realized the value of it. They said, can you get back all the furniture back? This is a architect called minimalist architect. He says less is more. He has, for the first time, he has put about 1,700 people, families in this huge one, only to have steel and glass. He is a minimalist architect. People say less is more, but less is also more. Well, next one, he is the one, he is a Gandhian architect who has brought back, he is a man who was influenced by Gandhi, but he is a Britisher. Next one, he is a lorry baker, he is called, who has bought a vernacular architecture, who said brick architecture, you come in, how you make, they said in your architecture you can't expand. Then he gave it, he has been done 100% all brickwork. He is recently passed away, not recently, couple of years, but his institute is there in Kerala, you can see even now, all the works. Oroville is one of the experimental cities in which they have adapting all the experiments, whether it's the earth, structure. The famous mother has given, then they have been experimenting all types of architecture. Next one, please. That is mother's handwritten sketch, based on which the building has been done. Can you, the little boy is not there. This is the galaxy, no, go back. This is the, ultimately it worked out, the galaxy has been formed. This is how the Auroville has been formed. It has been slowly taking place. That Matra Mandir has been taken for about 35 years to construct. He is architect Roger, Anger Roger, is with his model there now. This is some of the buildings there, what they have done. They're accepting this one. Is by Auroville architect, is a pyramid, is a Nataraja temple inside. Go ahead. The green building concept we have adapted, which is a sustainability, I've been saying about various things. Next one, this, I had an opportunity to design people school, which has been awarded green, the Indian Green Building Council, in which we have adapted all the, next one. This is a basic plan in which we have adapted the zonal areas, walls, floors, ceilings, solar panels, how to make use of the, without plastering of any walls we have done. The thermal conductivity has been reduced and so on. This is the architecture of this. Then can I go back? Next thing. These are various views which we have designed. That I should thank the authorities for this. is the future. Future they have a lot of things: floating cities, underground cities, kinetic cities, and dynamic cities. The architecture where it will start moving to the weather. Please go ahead. David Fisher has designed a rotating which produces electricity.
We decided to put wind turbines between the floors, as we have a space about 2 feet gap between one floor and another. So if I have...
You can push. This is some time back, Venkatesh asked in his quiz, who is the devil's architect? You would not believe this when by Hitler's capital. Hitler wanted a capital to be, the Europe to be designed by an architect, Albert Speer, who is a great architect. So, yeah, next one, please. No time. Okay, Carbuncle Cup winner. Okay, do you, any of you can guess what could be or why and what? Carbuncle is generally known for as Katti, Punnu Katti Udanda. This has been designed for the most ugliest buildings. This has been given for the ugliest buildings, they have given an award. That one as a walkie-talkie building has melted several automobiles because it is a concave. It is like a mirror. There is melted so many angles. They gave compensation to this, including one I had seen Gary's Disneyland. Disneyland has got a stainless steel roof which has been curved, and then he was sued by the residents because the glaring was so much they cannot open their window. Then they had to buff it. So this has been given Carbuncle's Cup for the worst buildings in various years. Go ahead. This most popular persons, I like Aishwarya Rai, and unfortunately could not complete her architecture, but Pink Floyd is able to do it. Samuel Jackson is a most popular pulp fiction. And then the most powerful man is Benjamin Netanyahu, who is a powerful prime minister of Israel. And of course, Pilu Modi, he wore a badge saying, I am a CIA agent. He is a true architect who is not related to our Modi, but he was a Swatantra Party man. Okay, please go ahead. Oh. So recently this it was burnt, you know, Paris. Immediately they called for a competition in which they have given an answer. This is a green building. They have made it to a green building. The first one, first one is a green building. The second one, as they wanted to have it as a light going to the sky. The third one is, he said, you must have a reminder, is a molten lead tower which has gone in. As this is how it has been made. He says this is how it should be. Next one, please. He said old and new to be combined. This is a new modern architecture with this. And then they said this has got to have, entire thing should have stained glass. This is a plan, in plan. This is in side elevation. This is another architecture, this. Please go ahead next. This is our architect's imagination. If you don't want any architect, please do it. You don't have to have an architect. He is able to do on his own. You can do it. Why not? He has made a place, he has made a roof, he has taken. You don't have to have an architect. Right? I would like to thank you all, and especially for those who have made help me, like Ashwin, Swaminathan, Venkatesan, and above all, I have to thank Chitra Hariharan for editing and proofreading and giving me permission to do so. Thank you so much.
We don't have much time, but we'll take a couple of questions if you have any. Not too detailed, long questions, quick and crisp. Anyone? Yes. 1 minute. Sorry,
pardon?
Hold on.
Largest temple?
The largest temples of the world or Angkor Thom and Angkor Wat in Cambodia.
Yeah.
So I heard that it was built by our own very own Rajaraja Chola, who went all the way to Cambodia and built those. So your thoughts on that?
Yeah, please kindly ask some historian about it. And we always have stories of people. And of course, our people have been marrying all the place, all over the places. So I am sure there will be somebody who will be there. Please. Angkor Wat, I have seen Angkor Wat. In your lifetime, you must go and see. You must go also to Indonesia, to Yogyakarta, where they have Prambanan and Borobudur. This is one of the greatest temples I have seen and enjoyed. Anybody else? Only temples? Yes, sir. Please, sir.
How do you see architecture moving in optimizing function, aesthetics, and cost?
Yeah. This is a million-dollar question. When you say cost, this is a million-dollar question because this is where we have been struggling. We are not able to make all the ends. So somewhere you have got to give a discount. Somewhere you have got to sacrifice. Somewhere you have got to go. It depends upon your priority. If you have only five rupees, you can't go to Saravana Bhavan. You have to go to a tea shop. So if you have 50 bucks, you can go to Saravana Bhavan and have a coffee. But it depends upon how you need it. So to optimize this is a work of an architect, an intelligence architect work.
Hi, sir. it was an extraordinary lecture.
Yeah.
But only... I'm very much interested in tribals and all.
Yeah.
I think even before Mahabharata, whatever people who lived in forest.
Yeah.
So they only, they were the first architects,
yeah,
whether it's 40,000 years or,
yeah,
50,000 years back.
Yeah.
And I wanted to know a little more about it. And what about the caves, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because most of the house architecture,
yeah,
a German Indologist proves it as a...
Yeah. I agree.
The
earliest caves man lived in, but the caves have not been designed by man. Caves have all been designed by nature. So he could adapt nature to suit his son.
You know, the house architecture based on that.
Yeah, okay. Based on, yeah, that he, yeah, could protect himself from animals, he could protect it, but he has never planned it. He has not planned a cave, but they could have his way out. Right, thank you so much.
Since Venkatesh inspired the topic of the lecture, I'd like Venkatesh to come over here and hand a token of our appreciation. He's also a Vastu person, so quite fitting, I think.
No, Venkatesh has inspired me in several things, just like Professor Swaminathan, who inspired us to come to the platform and talk whatever you want.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Anyhow, whatever is inside, I don't know. That has got to go back to forum.
Donation could be a courier. Okay. Thank you for all for coming. Next month, our speaker is Ramanan. Could you come up here for a second? Ramanan Jagannathan. He'll be speaking about very interesting new technology in genetics. It's called CRISPR, and it's very cutting edge. So we are going from all the way from the pyramids to, you know, very recent technology. Come up here. So Ramanan has volunteered to talk about CRISPR technology. So that's our topic next month. So thank you for coming. Hope to see you all next month.